Hi, I'm Clare Riesman, Assistant Manager of the Chadwick Garden, and today I'm going to talk to you about installing drip irrigation. Drip irrigation is an awesome way to water your garden. It's super efficient and it's a lot less complicated than it looks like. So today we're going to be going over two types of drip irrigation. One is T-tape and the other is emitter tubing. And we'll talk a little bit about the different types of irrigation systems and why you would choose one over the other. Before you install drip, you want to make sure it's the right system for the planting that you have in place. And so let me talk you through why we've chosen drip for this particular area in the garden. What we've got here are some young apple trees and some young roses. And for the last year or so that some of them have been in the ground, we've been overhead watering, and that's okay. But we want to transition to drip because roses in particular are susceptible to fungal disease when they get a lot of overhead water. And so if we switch over from overhead watering to drip, that's going to reduce our disease pressure on the roses themselves. So that's why we've chosen drip for this space. And in particular, we've chosen to use emitter tubing in this space, and that's in contrast to using T-tape. And that's because tape is thinner, tubing is a little thicker, and rose thorns tend to tear T-tape to pieces. So we're going with a thicker tubing to prevent tearing of our own lines. So that's why we've chosen the system we have for this space, and let's get looking at how to start our irrigation system. The first step for installing drip irrigation is to connect to your water source. So for us at the planting that we're doing today, that is at this hose bib here. And you could connect from the hose bib to your system with some distribution poly tubing line. It's a little bit more complicated, and so we're just going to keep it simple and we're starting with the hose today. So just your standard garden hose and screwed right onto the hose bib. The other reason I'm doing this here is because we have a little bit of a distance from our water source to where we're starting our system. So the hose is going to let us travel across some distance without doing too much installation. So now that I've got my hose plugged in up there, I'm going to bring it down to where I'm actually going to install my system. So the first step I'm going to do is install a pressure reducer, and this is just a hose threaded, so I can just installing it just means screwing it on. The pressure reducer is going to bring the pressure of the water coming out of the hose down to a level that's going to work with my tubing. So what I've done is I've looked at the specs for my tubing that came when I purchased it, and I can also look in a catalog or online and check it out. But the manufacturer is going to tell you what pressure that the system will work best at. And with drip tubing, you want to be mindful of that, because if you are trying to run the system at too high a pressure, a lot of the fittings will pop off. You'll get breaks and with water gushing everywhere, and you don't want that. Or you'll just get really uneven water flow rates coming out of the tubing. So check with your check the specs on the tubing, but in general for drip tubing, you can run it as low as 10 PSI and be okay. So I've got a 10 PSI pressure reducer here. I didn't install it up there because we've got a little bit of a slope here. And so as water comes downhill, it gains pressure. So if I bring it down to 10 PSI down up there and then it runs down the hill, it'll actually pick up more pressure and might be running at maybe more like 12 or 15 PSI down here. So put the pressure reducer on level with the top of your system. The next thing I've done is I've laid out what we call distribution tubing. This is just a line that has no holes in it. It's just used to carry water from one place to another. And so we line this out at the heads of all of our beds, call it a header. And this is what will carry water from the hose source to the lines themselves. So I've laid this across, and the next step is connecting it. To connect it, I'll use a piece we call a hose swivel, and it can come in a couple different varieties. This one here, so it's got this hose end that just screws right into hoses. This also has a washer that has sort of a mesh net on it, and that just keeps junk out of the line, which is really nice. So it's got the hose swivel on one end, and the other end connects to poly, the poly distribution line, distribution tubing. And this is a compression fitting. So this piece is a little cheaper, but harder to use. And then this piece is the same idea, but a little bit easier to use and also more expensive. And so we've got the hose swivel on one end, and then the other end has this barb. And so what you do is you just push the poly over the barb and then twist down and then connect it to your pressure reducer. The next step after I've set up my header is to line up my emitter tubing with the header itself.
This is the emitter tube. As you can see, it's got emitter holes roughly every 12 inches here. And these are not just holes poked into the tubing. It's an elaborate system that makes water sort of go through this torturous path and slow down so it dribbles out and it doesn't shoot out. So that's the mechanism that's going on inside of this tubing. Like I said, the emitters are spaced every 12 inches. You can also, with the tubing, get it spaced at 18 or 24 inches if you have plantings that are either farther apart or have more robust root systems that spread out really far and you don't need to have them as close. You can also get some variation in the what's called the flow rate coming out of each of these emitter holes. And so you can have it coming out at more like half a gallon per hour, a gallon per hour, something like that. And again, that's going to depend a little bit on your soil type. With clay soils, soils with high clay content, water doesn't absorb as quickly into those soils, and so water will tend to spread out more. And so with a clay soil, you want to have a slower flow rate coming out of these emitters because that allows the soil to not flood. On the other hand, if you have a sandier soil, sandy soils drain really quickly, and you actually do want to be adding water at a higher rate to sandy soils so that it can spread out a little more and not just go straight through your soil profile. So that's a little bit of an overview of selecting tubing. But once you've selected your tubing, you line it up along your bed and then line it up with your header here. And where the line meets the header, I'm gonna make a cut. I'm gonna use some sturdy garden clippers. Your kitchen scissors are not gonna make the right cut here. So we're gonna cut straight across. Nice clean cut. The next piece I'm using is this T-fitting, and this is gonna allow me to connect the header to the emitter tubing. You just wanna make sure you have the right size for these. And so this is all half inch tubing. So I'm gonna get a half inch T. And you can also get this in a compression fitting orientation, and we are using the twist lock version of it today. Again, a little bit more expensive, but way easier to use. So I'm just going to insert the tubing over the barb, twist it down, and then do the same thing on either side. So I'm just gonna keep doing the same thing down the line. One thing to think about is I do recommend starting at the water source end of your header and working your way down, because as you make cuts, it's going to change the width of the header a little bit. And so if you work in one direction, it means you'll everything will line up at the end. So again, just going to make a cut where the emitter tubing lines up with the distribution tubing. And I'm going to pop this T-fitting in to connect the emitter line to the header. So once you get to your last line on the header, you don't need to use a T because you don't need the header to continue. So because this header bends around a little bit, I'm able to just use a coupler to connect. But if it ends at more of a right angle, you can also use this elbow fitting. So what I'll do to add this coupler in is just cut at the point where I want the line to start, make a cut here. And then the same deal with the coupler as it is with the T. You just push the poly over the barb, twist down, push this over the emitter tubing, and we're connected. One advantage of this tubing that we're using today is that it's super durable and you can reuse it a lot. It can last for many years, even decades. And so instead of buying new tubing, I just pulled tubing from a planting that didn't need it anymore. And so as a result, my lengths aren't exactly right for this space, but what I can do is just take two smaller pieces and cut them to size and use this coupler. So this is where my first piece ends. I just throw the barb into the tubing, twist it down, same deal over here. And now I have one longer piece instead of two shorter pieces.
Once you've gotten to the end of your line, you're going to want to cap it. And this is a little too long. I could just wrap it around and this last tree could get a little extra love, but I'm going to show you how to cap the emitter line. So make sure you're not cutting into one of the emitter holes. Look for somewhere in between, make your cut,
And you've got a couple different options here. One is to have like a real end cap apparatus. And this is similar to the hose swivel we used at the start to connect our hose to our system. It's just a compression fitting on one end and hose on the other with this cap that screws on. The benefit of this is that it's easy in the winter, after the winter when we're getting our irrigation systems up and running again, we like to just flush the lines, and this is an easy way of opening up the line so that water can move through the system and any crud that's accumulated over the winter can move out. This is a very similar idea here. Again, it's instead of the compression, we have the twist lock and we can just put this on with the cap. And then these do cost some money. A way cheaper option is to fold this over and use this wire piece. And you link these wire pieces up, get this special twisting tool, hook it in, let's see if I can do it, and twist it down. You don't need a super tight twist. You just need to make sure that water is not moving through. Or you could also do it this way and put this special end cap on. I'll say alternatively, if you don't want to buy any special equipment, you could just fold it over and duct tape it down, and that also works fine. The last piece I'm going to put in place are these irrigation staples, and I'm just going to use that to hold the tubing in place near the roots of the plant. Especially with a lot of exposure to sun and then cold, the tubing can sort of move around, and we want to make sure that it stays. Because it's drip, it's not going to get a comprehensive wetting. And so part of what is necessary in a drip system is to make sure that the tubing and the emitters stay near the plant roots. So these irrigation staples help you keep that tubing in place. You don't need to use a million of them per bed. I just take a couple steps and put them in the ground. So every like 6 or 10 feet is a good distance. So now that everything is plugged in and screwed on, we're gonna turn on the hose and see if we did it right. Opening up the hose bib now, listening, it sounds like there's water moving through the system. So let's go check out how it's looking at the site. Okay, so now I'm gonna show you how to install T-tape. The reasons you would use T-tape are that it's cheaper, and it's lighter. It's more designed for a farm scale system. So also if you're working at a bit of a larger scale than the garden, this is a good option. And it's really well designed for flat annual crop growing. It doesn't take up a lot of space either. So a little overview of why we're using T-tape in this space. The space where we are now used to have some peaches in it. We've got one left over here who decided to stay. Peaches were not doing that well here, so we decided to take them out and convert it to some annual crops. And this year we've decided to plant potatoes. And we've done this special hilling technique to put the potatoes in the ground. That's why it looks so bumpy here. So we've got potatoes in the ground. We've overhead watered them a couple times to initiate growth. But potatoes, like some of its relatives, are very susceptible to a pathogen that gets transmitted through basically overhead watering. And so if there's rain or sprinklers or anything on the potatoes, with all of that water and all of that movement, the pathogen spreads and kills the crop. So basically once leaves emerge from the soil, we don't want to be overheading our potatoes, and we want to switch to drip. Again, it's more efficient, and in this case, it prevents some pathogen and pest disease and disease issues. So that's why we're using T-tape here. Let's show you how to get it started. Okay, so starting our system for the T-tape is very similar to starting our system for the emitter tubing. I've just plugged this hose into my hose bib here. I'm gonna get a pressure reducer and screw it on. I looked at the specs and the catalog for this T-tape, and it recommends that you run it at between 8 and 12 PSI. And so I've got this pressure reducer that brings it down to 10 PSI. Next, I need to connect it. I've laid out my header along the top of the beds, and I need to connect it. And so I'm gonna use a hose swivel and an elbow fitting to make that happen. So I've pulled this out a little farther than I need it. Just gonna cut into the header, AKA the distribution tubing. I'm gonna screw the hose swivel on, and it's got this compression end on this end for the poly. I'm just gonna muscle that in. And then I'm gonna use this elbow twist lock fitting to bring it all together and connect the start of my system to the header. In this system, I am reusing some old tubing from a system that doesn't need it anymore. And as a result, I've got some holes in my tubing. And one thing you can do is use these goof plugs to plug those holes. It's also helpful to use some needle nose pliers here, and you grab the small end with the needle nose pliers and just pop it in to the hole there to plug it up. Next step is that we are going to punch holes in our header to add these barbed connectors that connect the header to the T-tape. One trick you can use is often on this distribution line, there'll be a blue or a yellow line, and that's a good guide to make sure all of your barbed connectors are pointing at the same angle. Sometimes if you're not using that as a guide, you can have some pointing down, some pointing up, and it's kind of a pain in the butt. So you're gonna take your hole punch tool, line it up with the start of your bed, and with that blue line there, pop it in. And then this barb connector has this little barb on one end to sort of pop into the line there. This can get kind of tricky. You just gotta kind of muscle it in there. And then we'll eventually add our T-tape in here. But first I'm gonna add the barbed connectors along the hole header first. Okay, so now I've attached all of the barbed connectors that connect the header to the T-tape, or that will connect the header to the T-tape, and I've come to the end of my header. It goes on longer than I need it to. So what I'm gonna do is just give myself a little wiggle room in case I need to add anything later. Make that cut, and I've got my hose end cap. And again, this is good. I could use this cap to flush out the line in between seasons. And it's got a compression fitting on the end, so I'm just gonna muscle it on, and my header's good to go. So next, I'm gonna attach the T-tape to the header. So we've got our little very low-tech setup here. We just put two forks in the ground, a PVC pipe through the spool of T-tape, and that's gonna hold it up for me and make it easy to roll. And I'm just gonna walk the T-tape up the slope. And then when I get to the top here, I'm just gonna twist back this lock, put the T-tape over the barb, and this is a little harder than with the poly. Get it over and then twist it down, and it's connected. So at the end of the line, I'm gonna give myself a little bit of extra room because I'm gonna do some folding over, and because should there be a break in the line during the season, I might need to cut out some line. So I give myself a little extra room, make a cut, and what I'll do is fold, fold, give a little gap, fold again, pinch, and slide this over. And this T-tape is capped. So now that we've installed our T-tape and capped the ends, it's time to turn on the system and see how it goes. So it does look like there are some leaks, so let's go look at them closer. So because I've reused this T-tape after a couple years, we try to get as much use out of it as possible to just keep plastic from going in the landfill. Sometimes that means it's gonna get some tears in it. So indeed we have a tear here, but it's okay, it's very fixable. I'm gonna pull it a little taut, not super taut because it'll come out of its coupler there, but I'm just gonna cut out the gash there. Try to get as clean of a cut as possible. And then use this piece, which is called a T-tape coupler, and just slide the barb under the T-tape here. Get the T-tape over. Same deal on this end. Twist it down. Make sure it's nice and tight. So we patched up all of the leaks that were in the T-tape, and now it's running great. So those are the basics of how to set up a T-tape and an emitter tubing system. And I really recommend it in your backyard if you're able to, and I hope that if it's something you were interested in, but it seemed a little overwhelming, that this video has helped it seem a little bit more manageable and that you feel empowered to go out and install a drip system in your backyard. So have fun and happy gardening.